On this week's show, Tesla CEO Elon Musk reveals the second part of his grand master plan. A solar-powered plane makes aviation history, and a Nissan LEAF with double the battery capacity goes racing. These stories and more coming up next on 10. Enjoying today's show on YouTube and want to read the stories we're referring to today? Just head to our website at transportevolve.com/TEN, where you'll find today's show notes, as well as links to the latest future car news, buying guides, tech primers, and car reviews. It's Friday, July 29th, 2016. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield, and it's good to be back in the saddle after a week off. Did you miss me? We start today's show with the Elon Musk evil master plan part two for Tesla Motors, along with the news of the opening of Tesla's Gigafactory. Last week, 10 years ago to the day that Tesla unveiled its revolutionary two-seat all-electric Roadster, Musk published a blog post on Tesla.com detailing what he hoped would be next for the brand, starting, as you might expect, with a merger between Tesla and SolarCity. Alongside that vision, where Tesla will one day sell you everything from a solar power system for your home to a domestic backup power system and zero-emission electric car from just one store, Musk said he wanted Tesla to expand its vehicle lineup to include pickup trucks, full-size all-electric big rigs for hauling freight, and even design brand new mass transit systems for city centers. At the same time, Musk hinted in his post at a future where Tesla owners will be able to make extra money from their cars by renting out their self-driving cars when they don't need them. Aside from demonstrating that Tesla, whose Gigafactory is now officially open for business in Reno, Nevada, really does have big plans for the future, it's also a very exciting vision of the future. Now, Tesla has that to make that dream come reality, and we'll be watching very carefully as it tries to do just that. Of course, Tesla isn't the only automaker thinking big this week either. German luxury brand Porsche, which really wants a piece of Tesla's pie, announced this week that it's expanding its staff yet again to increase the number of people working on its Mission E electric sports sedan. Unveiled as a concept last year, the Mission E is due to go on sale by 2020. To make sure that happens, Porsche has just hired an additional 400 people on top of the 1,000 it hired earlier this year to work exclusively on Mission E. The most recent hiring, including 110 IT specialists, 50 creatives, and more than 70 apprentices, mirrors an industry-wide push towards electric vehicles and shows how eager the German brand is to catch up with Tesla and BMW in the luxury plug-in car marketplace. Also worth noting is the comment made by Porsche's product director for the famed 911, who said that while Mission E is full steam ahead for production, an electric 911 isn't in the brand's future anytime soon. Sadness. We're off to Japan next, where this week Nissan announced that it believes the number of CHAdeMO DC quick charging stations for cars like the Nissan LEAF and Mitsubishi Outlander plug-in hybrid have reached critical mass. Translated, it essentially means that Nissan believes the number of public CHAdeMO DC quick charging stations in Japan has reached a point where there are so many, and they are so easy to access, that there's really no excuse for not owning an electric car anymore. As of right now, there are just over 7,000 charging stations in Japan with CHAdeMO capabilities, equivalent to one every 17 square kilometers. We should note here that CHAdeMO is the preferred charging standard for DC quick charging in Japan, and even cars like the BMW i3 come with CHAdeMO as standard for the Japanese market. So it's no surprise that the charging standard is so well supported. With more charging stations planned, there's really no excuse for not dumping the pump for good, especially when you can consider that you can use CHAdeMO to power your home during a major earthquake in Japan, thanks to vehicle-to-grid systems like LEAF to Home. It's all pretty logical. Nearly 2 months after a fatal crash in which a Tesla Model S electric car crashed into a tractor-trailer unit in Florida, killing the car's driver instantly, the U.S. National Highway Traffic Safety Administration has released a preliminary report into the accident. As I'm sure you're already aware, one of the reasons this accident has attracted so much attention is because Tesla's autopilot system was activated at the time of the collision, making it the first fatal road accident involving a semi-autonomous vehicle. But this week, NHTSA announced that the deceased driver was speeding at the time of the accident, with the car's autopilot system set to drive at 74 miles per hour rather than the posted 65 miles per hour limit on the road. That difference, equivalent to around 13.2 feet per second traveled, would likely have not made any difference in the outcome of the crash had all other factors remained the same, but it does point the blame more towards the driver of the car than the car itself. Of course, the investigation is still undergoing and the outcomes won't be known for some time. But it's also worth adding here that Tesla quietly severed ties this week with Mobileye, the company it's been using to supply it with certain pieces of hardware for its first generation autopilot system, which is about to be superseded by the second generation system. It's not clear if this was a pre-planned incident or a consequence of the crash, so we can't comment further on this. But we also note this week that NHTSA made a separate statement in which it said the fatal crash involving autopilot won't result in the derailing of all autonomous vehicle programs, which, frankly, is a very sensible and fair move. Taking to the skies next, we watched in awe this week as Solar Impulse 2, piloted by Bertrand Piccard, successfully landed in Abu Dhabi, completing its 40,000-kilometer round-the-world trip without burning a drop of fossil fuels. The single-seat airplane, custom-made for this trip, features a carbon fiber construction, solar panels on pretty much every available surface, a quartet of electric motors and twin battery packs that it charges up during the day to ensure that it can keep flying at night. Sadly, though, it won't be replacing that transatlantic gas guzzler yet. Its payload isn't all that impressive, and it travels at an agonizingly slow 56 miles per hour during the day and 37 miles per hour at night. But that's really not the point here, because just like the first internal combustion-engined airplanes, this one is bound to evolve into something far more impressive in the next two or three decades. It just happens to be the first in what we hope will be a long line of capable long-distance planes, and that makes us very excited indeed. Congratulations to Piccard, fellow pilot Andre Boschberg, and the rest of the Solar Impulse team on this fantastic, historic flight. Back on the ground with our next story, we're off to Mercedes-Benz now, which announced this week a brand new all-electric truck that's capable of carrying 26 tons and can travel up to 125 miles per charge of its 212 kilowatt-hour battery pack. Called the Mercedes-Benz Urban E-Truck, the vehicle has three axles and is in a fixed chassis rather than the articulated one you'd find on larger vehicles. There's also a smaller two-axle variant, the Daimler Verso Canter E-Cell, rated to carry 6 tons, which is already undergoing testing. But the larger vehicle, in its battery pack, situated between the chassis legs, means there's no loss of cargo space. Moreover, it's perfect for cities like London, where commercial vehicles have to pay an arm and a leg to drive into the centre of town. It also has quick charging as standard, so refueling won't take forever. Of course, electric delivery vehicles have been around forever, but this is the first time we've seen a major truck maker take steps to bring such a vehicle to market that has anywhere near this kind of payload. Previously, large load electric vehicles were either niche market or heavily restricted in terms of range or performance, so this truck has definitely piqued our interest. With the Mercedes-Benz Urban E-Truck just about to enter service in a few test fleets in Germany, it's still away from production, but we'll be keeping a close eye on this particular program to see how well it fares. Of course, Tesla is single-handedly responsible for many an automaker suddenly deciding to develop electric cars, and this week it appears that its runaway success in the premium segment is prompting British luxury brand Jaguar to put its development of an all-electric big cat at the top of its priorities list. As Automobile magazine reported this week, Jaguar is actually cancelling two different sports car projects at its UK headquarters so that it can focus more effectively on bringing an all-electric sedan and an all-electric SUV to market. Details are sparse right now, but the sedan, codenamed X590, is said to be a four-door sedan with a coupe feel, while the SUV will be designed to go head-to-head with the Audi Q6 e-tron that's due to go on sale in 2018. It just goes to show that Tesla's successes in the electric car world really has changed attitudes to zero-emission vehicles, and we can't wait to see what Jaguar's first electric cars will look like. Watch this space. With the entire US now well into presidential election season, you might be forgiven for thinking that the current US administration had kind of given up on all it could on encouraging electric vehicle mass adoption. But it turns out that this just isn't the case. Last week, the Obama administration said it will invest up to $4.5 billion to build more electric car charging stations across the country in an attempt to cure range anxiety, with some of that money coming in the form of a Department of Energy loan guarantees, as well as the creation of a new partnership levels between all levels of government and automakers themselves. As part of this, the administration says it wants to see a national network of DC rapid charging stations and the formation of a coalition between 50 different automakers, utility companies, and charging providers in an attempt to make driving an electric car easier wherever you happen to live in the US. At the same time, the Obama administration said it wants to do everything it can to encourage automakers to bring a range of affordable, practical electric cars to the market that can manage ranges in excess of 200 miles per charge or more. Of course, doing isn't the same as talking, so we'll be paying close attention to see what happens in the coming months and what President Obama's successor does to either further or quash that goal. One thing that won't be hampering the goal, however, is the sale of diesel-powered Volkswagen cars in the US. That's because Volkswagen finally ceased all plans to sell diesel-powered TDI cars in the US last week, as a direct consequence of the Dieselgate scandal. Having concluded that it's just not cost-effective to design and produce diesel vehicles for the US market, Volkswagen also announced this week that while it hopes to introduce many new electric cars to the US market in the coming years, it hopes to be building electric cars in the US within 9 years, a target that would not only save it money in terms of shipping, but also help the US economy too. Given the challenges facing Volkswagen, however, it's going to be interesting to see just what those new cars will be, or indeed which ones will be US made. But I'm curious to know if you'd want to buy an electric Volkswagen after everything we've been through with Dieselgate. I know if it's electric, I'm personally okay with buying an electric VW, but what about you? Let me know in the comments below. And finally, if you've ever owned a Nissan LEAF, I've had two, you'll know that the original 24 kilowatt hour lithium ion battery pack that came with pre-2016 Nissan LEAFs wasn't really quite as large as many of us would have liked. Yes, if you were careful, 100 miles was possible, but in everyday driving, a more realistic expectation has always been between 60 and 70 miles. Well, it turns out that a bunch of Nissan engineers at the Nissan Technical Center in Barcelona, Spain, thought the same thing, and a few years ago started on a skunkwork project Nissan LEAF with not one but two battery packs so that they could compete in the Eco Series race events where energy efficiency is just as important as how fast you go. We first heard about the car last year and actually covered it on the show, but Nissan's recent press release has included some nice video of it in action and that extra battery pack shoved in where the rear seats normally live. So we thought it was worth including this unusual, specially made race car in the show. Of course, when the next generation LEAF comes out with its 60 kilowatt hour battery pack, this LEAF's 48 kilowatt hour battery pack will seem a bit small. But hey, it's all good. Kept those engineers out of trouble, right? And on that note, I'm afraid that's all we have for today's show. As usual, don't forget to leave your reactions and thoughts to the stories we've covered in the comments below, as well as giving us a thumbs up and a share if you liked it. And if you didn't, give us a thumbs down and tell us why, because, you know, otherwise we can't improve. As some of you may have picked up, things in the Gordon Bloomfield family have been a little tough of late. So I can't promise when the next show will be, but I'm gonna do my best to be back next week with a show for you all to enjoy, as well as news of a change to Transport Evolved that will shift our attention away from written prose and more heavily towards video, because that's what you all seem to want. In the meantime, don't forget to visit our website at transportevolve.com for daily articles. Follow us on Twitter at transportevolve, or check out our latest shows on our usual YouTube channel. And if you liked what you saw today, please do consider keeping us independent and impartial by supporting our Patreon crowdfunding campaign from as little as $1 per month over at patreon.com/transportevolved. Although we've just had to cancel our plans for an office due to family problems, we're always grateful for any donations you're willing to give. And right now, they're helping us ensure the content keeps flowing. So thank you if you're one of the many who do help us out. As always, there are some stories we didn't manage to fit into today's show, including how Nissan's autonomous driving system is learning from anthropologists, Tesla and SolarCity edge closer to that all-important merger, our writer Kate Walton Elliott drools over a very rare classic electric car from the 1960s, and we tell of a tale of horror involving air conditioning and one of our staff 2002 Toyota RAV4 EVs. So when we're done, be sure to head to our site to read them all. Thanks for watching. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield. Have a fantastic weekend. And until next time, keep evolving. Yeah, I know. And this is how I got through today's show. I have feet on. They are fluffy feet. See, I have fluffy feet. I don't care.